It is Thursday, the 2nd of October, 2014, and it's time for Try Hard Thursday number 38. Coming at you live here on twitch.tv/Invicta, also on the VODs, youtube.com/Invicta316. We are all set and ready to go for game numero uno. Before we get to the game, a couple of announcements really fast here. If you would like to have a chance to play in tonight's Try Hard Thursday, you have a really good chance here to do so. Just join the North American group chat, or North American League of Legends server group chat or chat room, depending on how you look at it. Sinvicta, that's where we're going to be taking invites from. There is no subscriber invite priority tonight, so those of you who are non-subs, lucky you get a chance to get in the game. Also, don't forget that tomorrow's Friday Night Fan Fights. There's also going to be no sub priority for that. And this coming Sunday, which is going to be the 5th of October, is going to be the next episode of SS Radio. I always do an SS Radio on the first Sunday of every single month, and the 5th of October happens to be the first Sunday of this month. So don't miss it, especially those for you here on Twitch. It's very, very important that everyone shows up to it, or at least checks out the VODs. Those VODs will not be made on YouTube. So if you are listening to this on YouTube, make sure you don't miss it on this Friday, because I promise you, you're going to want to tune in for that. Looks like the players are loaded up. The game is ready to begin. Everyone's changing their colors to match which team they want to win. Of course, I am rooting for purple because purple is just my team. Here we are on Summoner's Rift spawning on the purple side, which is actually technically the red side right now. Again, I don't know why my settings keep changing for colorblind, but whatever. It's just the teams right now spawning on Team Purple. Playing in the support lane, it's going to be Jabonski as support Nami. ADC Miss Fortune is going to be played by Beacons. In the mid is going to be Malzahar, played by Fire Bear Zero. In the Jungaloo on Amumu, who's apparently already going back already, is going to be Leo Von Newton. Or just probably call him Leo. And last but not least, up in the top lane, playing as Aurelia, is going to be Ryu Vashi. And spawning for Team Blue in the support lane is going to be ADC Jinx, played by St. Ulfric. His support is going to be Morgana, played by Mormagil. In the Jungaloo is going to be Spirit of Fire, playing as Jungle Vi. In the mid, it's going to be Demonic Karazaki, playing as Ezreal. Last but not least, in the top lane for Team Blue, it's going to be Gatecrasher, playing as Nasus. Game 1 is set and ready to go. Everyone rooting for the teams right now. I'm rooting for Team Purple. Again, Team Purple has been trailing in the standings for quite a while now. Actually, I think since the beginning of Try Hard Thursday, Team Blue has always had the upper hand. So we are set. All kinds of ready for game number one at Try Hard Thursday number 38. And again, keep in mind that you can still get a chance to play tonight. Just join the North American League of Legends server chat room, Sinvicta. Like I said, it's gonna be a non-subs free week this week. Just because I like y'all a whole lot. See Malzahar going up against Ezreal mid. Ezreal mid, not really someone that you usually see playing mid, gotta be honest. I think that he was played in mid at one point of his existence, but lately he's kind of fallen off to, you know, better mid laners, I guess. Debatably called better. You see Dark Binding landing there on Nami, not that big of a deal. Seeing a huge resurgence in Nami lately. She's now considered probably the top tier support outside of Morgana and Lulu. Dark Binding actually hits through the brush line, which, to be quite honest, I don't think, I would not have expected that Dark Binding to go all the way through there. The lane to watch is definitely going to have to be mid lane, though. I'm interested and curious to see how that works out for Ezreal. Again, as a reminder, we do balance the teams before the games have begun, as you see a nice little Aqua Prisoner landing on Mormagil. And Morgana taking a lot of damage, so is Beacons. Oh, Dark Binding's going to land on Beacons. Heal command for Nami. One more shot from Fishbones. Not going to make it. Beacons barely escaping, had to force the flash though. Nice job there, good pressure by St. Ulfric. And Beacons got to be careful. Dark Binding has landed on Jabonski. First blood is going to go to Jinx, and they're also going to get another Summoners out of that. So Jinx even pursuing Nami against the outer turret in the support lane. But nice job overall by Jinx. First blood goes to Team Blue. I'm pretty sure this is like the 10th week in a row that Team Blue has gotten the first blood, something like that, game one. Jabonski needs to be careful. There's no warding right now. The only ward he has is in the bottom is in the bottom bush there on the sport lane. Gatecrasher in a lot of trouble. Sad Mummy, or not, I'm sorry, not Sad Mummy, but Despair going out. Ticking, ticking, ticking. Actually, barely out of reach of Nasus, and Nasus will live somehow. Barely able to escape Gatecrasher there. There's so much damage that was coming in. I actually think that Amumu's Despair was not actually technically hitting Nasus, because he definitely would have died had that been the case. But again, all eyes are going to be on the middle lane. If Ezreal can keep Malzahar under control, it's going to be good for Team Blue, but Malzahar is no slouch. See, Leo Von Newton. We'll probably end up just calling Leo, like I said. Had the opportunity to actually finally play Nasus the other day in a bot game. Nasus is quite easy and also quite fun. Not really played at the pro level, though. He doesn't really have any gap closers. He's got great solo potential, but if you're talking about... If you're talking about more versatile top laners, Nasus kind of falls by the wayside, and he even falls to like Aurelia, Jax, Rengar. I would say that pro teams are more likely to pick Rengar than Nasus. And you know, you've seen the resurgence of Rumble coming out here thanks to Dyrus on TSM. He's pretty much pioneering the return of Rumble in top lane, and Rumble certainly brings a lot more to a team fight than Nasus does. Now, the problem with Nasus is that he just can't get away. He can slow down people, but he really is limited as far as defense goes, even though he's tanky as all hell. Going up against Aurelia is going to be... That's basically just going to be a wet pool noodle slugfest up there. Not going to be a whole lot of damage going on in the top lane for quite a while. You'll see another Darkbinding landing on Beacons. Beacons, once again, has got to be careful. She was standing on Corrupted Soil. And it's because she was rooted, and then she also got zapped. So Beacon's having some difficulties farming in the support lane right now. But outside of the first blood, no real action. We had a couple of gank attempts in the mid lane that didn't really materialize into anything. Snami there landing the Aqua Prison. I mean, it kind of landed. It landed on creep. Another Darkbinding landing on Beacons. Beacons taking so much damage. One more volley from Fishbones may have done it. I'm surprised that Jinx didn't try to land a zap there. Beacons, as well as Javonski, going to be forced to head back out there. I should mention that I believe that we have a couple. We have two or three members. I'm not going to say their names, but I think that two or three of these players are actually brand new, like literally brand new players to League of Legends, which is always very fun. I like seeing that sort of. I guess attraction to League. League is it's not an easy game to get into, but once you kind of get the basics, what was that? A Smite War and Flash War coming over just because of the Ghoul Pack. I don't know what that was. But Mumu and Vi both blew their flashes just to get the Smite. That's a first for me. I mean, getting the Ghoul Pack's pretty nice, but I don't think it's worth using summoners for it. Not sure what that was. Now Team Blue looking to make a push on the Dragon. And Team Purple has no idea about this. They do actually know they don't have any wards in the river at all. So this is going to be an uncontested Dragon kill for Team Blue. And Purple, unfortunately, has no idea this is going on. And Team Blue is going to go up ahead by a whole lot. There you go. 1,400 gold separates these two teams. Only one kill, but... Of course, the dragon, by the way, for those of you who do not know, the dragon equals 1,000 gold spread across the entire team. The extra money came from the first blood, as well as the remedial differences in farming and whatnot. So far, both teams playing pretty much dead even. Spirit of Fire has got to be careful. He might actually go down here. He doesn't have smite because he's on the dragon, and a minion's going to kill Vi. I guess that's a blessing in disguise, though, because when Vi comes back, she will... I mean, that counts as a death, but it doesn't really... It counts as an execution. So Spirit of Fire will be able to at least start with fresh buffs, but you definitely don't want to be dying. Dying is about the last thing you want to do, especially to creep. That's all right. Another Darkbinding. Ashley's going to miss that time there. Corrupted Soul not going to land on anybody. Ezreal just face-tanking Malzahar, which... Not usually the best of ideas. Really, a calling missing on top lane. Nasus currently back buying. Take a look overall at the gold earned as we sit here approaching the 10-minute mark of game number one of Triad Thursday, number 38. It's going going to be no surprise. Jinx, ADC Jinx there, played by St. Ulfrich. Ulfrich. It's not Lars Ulrich. It's St. Ulfrich. Jinx sitting at around 2,600 champion value for Team Blue. Team Purple is going to be led by mid lane Malzahar, 2,400 gold. Nicely done. Malzahar doing a very nice job there, out farming Ezreal. He's actually going to dive this turret. I don't know if that's the right idea. Malzahar is going to get a kill, but it's going to be a counter kill. Not really worth it. It's not really worth to dive a turret if you're just going to trade one for one. And especially if you're not going to have any backup, you can't guarantee that the turret's going to go down to minions. So they end up trading 300 for 300, and pretty much no one wins at that point. Team Blue still up by 1,200 gold. And Nasus is just going to continue farming on there. So kind of a whiff there on the Dark Binding. That's all right. Morgana's been landing the Dark Bindings pretty nicely. Here comes Amumu coming in from the river. Is going to land the Banish Toss, and the Tsunami has come out as well. What an ultimate there from Jablonski, landing right on Morgana. St. Ulfrich is going to be able to escape, but what a nice play there by Nami, showing you the reason why Nami's considered one of the top-tier supports right now. The range on Tidal Wave is huge. It's massive. Very, very fantastic play, setting up a kill for the jungler. Spirit of Fire now coming in for a gank on Aurelia. Aurelia's super duper tanky. There goes Wither, and I don't think that, I'm not sure what Ryu Vashi was expecting on happening there. I feel that he could have easily gotten away. I don't know why he decided to fight a 2v1. I mean, Aurelia's tanky, but she's not that tanky. So, it's just another case of one step forward, two steps backwards for Team Purple. Here we are, once again, week by week. So Mumu looking to get some retribution for Aurelia. He sees Nasus, but he does not see Vi. And now Mumu, well, I guess if there's one person you want defending a turret while Aurelia's down, it's going to be a Mumu. And here comes Firebeard coming in from the middle, actually. Gatecrash is going to go down and kill Ghost to Malzahar. Can they take out Vi here? It'll be a huge get for Team Purple. The Banish Toss is not going to be able to reach, and Vi able to Vault Breaker away out of there. But nice job there by Malzahar roaming up to the top lane and grabbing a kill to levy the pressure off of the top lane just a bit. And look at this, the mid lane and top lanes have actually switched, because now here comes Ezreal. Ezreal's not safe there. He doesn't actually see where Amumu is. At the same time, Team Blue is pushing onto the support lane, outer turret there. So Spirit of Fire forced to back off along with Ezreal. Nasus now teleporting in, and you do see... Ezreal using his ult because hell, why not? Now they have three members of Team Blue trying to save the outer turret. That teleport from Nasus is going to do that. So we're all tied up 3-3 right now, but Team Purple still trailing by 1,000 gold. That's the gold differential from the first dragon. And Chompers are going to land another tidal wave coming out here from Jablonski. But the Chains of Corruption also went out. Not Chains of Corruption. It's called, don't tell me, Soul Shackles. That's what it's called. Soul Shackle. Soul Shackle was ticking on both Nami and Beacons. Apparently Arcade Misfortune shoots her TV after playing Duck Hunt. So there's that. St. Ulfrich gets an easy peasy kill there, and Ezreal's not going to be able to escape Malzahar either. And that's what I was talking about. Malzahar's ultimate, so scary with that root and the silence. Amumu actually was going after Morgana, and I don't know if that was the right play, because now he's forced to run away. He is going to get zapped. At the same time, Nasus pushing up in the outer turret lane. Here comes Beacons saving Amumu. Nice play there by Beacons, the freshly rezzed Beacons saving Amumu. Aurelia and Nasus going to be hitting each other with the pool noodles, and it's going to be one slobber knocker, that's for sure. It's going to be quite the long fight. So overall, 4-4. You see the gold differential there. Almost 2,000 gold now. Actually, it's sitting at 2,100 gold. Spirit of Fire. Oh, what a bandit toss coming in from Amumu. And Spirit of Fire forced the Vault Breaker away. He was going to try to take the blue buff Firebeard now. Fire Bear, I should say, coming after Spirit of Fire, not going to be able to catch her, as Vi is quite quick. Vi is surprisingly mobile for a champion that you wouldn't expect to be mobile. Oh, St. Ulrich! St. Ulfrich indeed, and here comes Assault and Battery! Spirit of Fire running into a 3v1, I'm not sure if that's the best play. He somehow was able to get a kill on Beacons. I don't think Beacons really needed to die there. She could have possibly kited away, but here comes the counterattack coming in from Ezreal, and he is going to completely dodge Curse of the Sad Mummy, and Ezreal forced to escape out of there. So it ends up, whoa, tidal wave. I think a tidal wave hit all the way from Japan from Jabunski. I'm not really sure. People are just using alts just for the hell of it at this point. So it ends up being a 2-for-1 trade for Team Purple, 6-5 now, as the gold differential has now been pretty much squished back to 1,000 gold. And again, it's all going to revolve around that uncontested dragon kill. And speaking of uncontested dragon kills, Purple could actually make a play for the dragon if they wanted to. So 800 gold lead now for Team Blue, and Team Purple's been doing a pretty nice job on most of the lanes, but bottom lane has been a real problem for Purple as they cannot handle the range of Jinx and the roots of Morgana. Irelia there counter warding a vision ward, and it's going to turn into a 2v1 gank attempt on Nasus. Nasus got a long way to go. Doesn't matter. He's got Triforce. Got Boots of Swiftness, and he's going to be completely fine. He's working for Triforce, I believe. He does have Sheen. That was Sheen that we saw proc, by the way. I was going to say, it's a little bit early for Nasus to have a Triforce here. He must have been farming real hard. You see at the 15.5-minute mark, Purple is already backed up to their inner turret on the bot lane, and that turret's not long for this world if they don't get help from their jungler. At the same time, Gatecrash is doing a lot of damage on Ryu Vashi. I don't think Siphoning Strike's powerful enough to go through Aurelia's defense. Not right now, anyway. So 6-5, Team Purple is actually leading in kills, but they're still down in gold. And again, that will be attributed to the combination of just being out-farmed along with that dragon kill. The dragon kill is pretty much 99% of that, let's put it that way. Nice Hawk Prison there landed by Nami on Morgana. And once again, Miss Fortune is going to get caught by Zap, but luckily she used her ult to get away. Here comes the Bandage Toss landing on Gatecrasher. Can Nasus get away? Irelia not there. She had to back off because she was taking so much damage. One more Siphoning Strike, she would have been dead. Here comes the teleport coming in from Ezreal. Can Malzahar get a cancel? No, just barely. At the same time, Vi is in the mid now, taking over. I don't know why Vi was hesitating there. I feel like if Malzahar had canceled the teleport on Ezreal, that would have been really, really power. That would have been a I don't want to say Vi's fault, but I feel like Vi should have probably pressed the advantage. I mean, they had 2v1 in the mid, but we are going to see Miss Fortune go down yet again. But at the same time, Team Purple is going to take out the outer turret in mid lane, and we are all tied up on turrets. Here comes Vi, Vault Breakering in. He's going to land on Firebeer, but I don't know why I keep calling Firebeer, Firebearer. But you do see there, Vi does not really have enough damage to to do that much. She's not that big of a threat yet. I mean, she's got the outer lizard stone, I'll give her that. I'm not sure what she's building next. Looks like Mercury Treads, but she's definitely going to need some damage. They've got tankiness in the form of Nasus, who actually is not building that tanky. It looks like there's going to be a contest here for the blue buff, and I believe that the blue buff was taken by... Did Vi end up getting the blue buff? Yes, she did. Okay. It's a nice attempt there. A little bit of counter jungling here and there from Amumu, and Vi too. So that vision ward is going to be able to let everyone know on Team Purple that, hey, we've got bogeys at our tri-bush. Yeah, it's fire beer. It's a new drink. Hot new drink. It's like flaming Dr. Peppers. And St. Ulfric finding himself caught in a 1v3 situation. Kind of overkill, if you ask me. Really didn't need to have three ultimates for that, but that's all right. Actually, I don't think Miss Fortune didn't actually use her ultimate. Down goes the outer turret. Here comes the Mumu coming from the side. Curse Mummy, Curse of the Sad Mummy ticking on Nasus. Nasus is able to get a Siphoning Strike off. Can he make it 2-for-1? Ryu Vashi going to be pushed back by Ezreal along with Nasus. As there was no mid lane roam there for mid because Malzahar was headed towards the bot lane. So 7-7, but down goes another turret for Team Purple, and Blue really is keeping control of the top lanes, the outer lanes anyway. Mid lane has been pretty much won by Malzahar. But he's been having to do a lot of roaming just because of the fact that all the other lanes are being pushed very hard, making it rain, slowing it down on Morgana. And this turret is not long for this world. Three people on the turret. Here comes Vi coming from the side. Missed Aqua Prison attempt there. Vi needs to be careful. They're not safe there. Beacons is trying to land the ult. Didn't matter. Exhaust going out there. Landed by Morgana. Making it rain. Slow down. I don't know why Malzahar and Nami are not helping Beacons. And Soul Shackle goes down. Super Mega Death Racket lands on the money. Now it's turning into a 3v2. I really don't know why Malzahar and Nami did that. They kind of left Misfortune out to pretty much hung out to dry. And what would have been, what should have been a 3v2 turned into a 3v2 for the opposite team. So a little bit of miscommunication there from Malzahar and Nami. In fact, we'll go back and take a look at that really fast and slow it down. There was really no reason for Misfortune to die here. I mean, none at all. They had a lot of pressure coming in on the turret. You see Vi coming in from left. Right now, it's a 3v2. There's no reason why Purple should not be fighting this at all. I don't know why Malzahar and Nami both are running away. Nami doesn't have her ultimate. Malzahar also does not have his ultimate. But it's still a 3v2 right now, even before this teleport. And unfortunately, this is all damage that they could have been doing, but Soul Shackle went out, Super Mega Death Rocket came in, and now it turned into a 3v2 on the opposite end. And we all saw how it ended. So a little bit of unfortunate circumstance there. Kind of hung out Beacons out to dry. Here comes Rillia coming in from the top lane. And again, it's still a 2v3 here. St. Ulfric's starting to get pretty scary on Jinx. Another kill goes down. Ezreal's ultimate almost taking out Amumu. So 10-8 now is a big swing. The first real big swing of the game happens in favor of Team Blue. It seems to be the common trend for most of the Tryhard Thursdays. Gonna be another uncontested dragon kill. People were saying because Nami was out of mana, she wasn't completely out of mana. Even then, mana doesn't, or auto attacks don't need to use mana. So I do not accept that argument. There's a 3v2 there, and it should have gone the other way for Team Purple. Zap's gonna land on Malzahar. Another easy peasy four on one gank there, and Team Purple really starting to get shut down quite rapidly. 11-8, 4,600 gold lead. Favorite Team Blue, and Purple starting to really fall apart. They definitely have the stronger team fight, in my opinion anyway, with a combination of Nami along with Amumu. They've got a couple really, really good initiators. Their single target DPS is a little bit lacking, though. But the late game, really, honestly, the late game of Team Blue really favors them way more than Team Purple does. Let's put it that way. So 11-8 now, as Purple really needs to start banding together and start forcing some good team fights. Because the longer this game goes on, if you look at the fact that there's basically two ADCs on Team Blue really puts them on the edge. It gives them much more of an advantage late game than it does for Team Purple, just because of Ezreal and Jinx both have the ability to get pretty big and scary. And Malzahar, while he can be quite good, he's not that scary. He really just has shutdown with his ultimate. And there's a nice kill there by Malzahar. It's going to land two here. Down goes Ezreal. Can they get three? Curse of the Sad Mummy is able to stop St. Ulfric in the tracks. There's a shutdown. Finally, Beacons grabs herself a kill. She really needed that gold. And a huge, huge team victory there for Team Purple, swinging a 3-0 scam in favor of the good guys. And Purple now on the warpath, trying to get caught up. That's exactly what they needed to do. They caught Ezreal a little bit too overextended, took him out. Morgana tried to save him, didn't happen. And then Jinx was too late to the party and too early to escape. And she was able to get caught up there by Team Purple. Purple should get at least an inner turret out of this. So that inner turret's going down. Here comes Nasus. They're not going to get another turret. That's surprising. Amumu was not pushing the mid lane. He was actually going for the outer turret in the support lane. So Amumu is, if he can push this, if Leovon Newton can get this turret, then I guess it makes that trade a little bit better. But it would have been nice for them to get a tier 2 turret Unfortunately, they were not. They got some good damage on it, but they did not take it down. You do see Amumu taking down the second turret for Team Purple. All tied back up. 2 turrets to 2. 11 to 11. A very close game now. But again, I do have to. I am worried. I say the good guys, by the way. That's not any slight on any Team Blue members. It's, everyone knows that I root for Purple. For now, anyway. But the late game composition kind of worries me for Team Blue. They've got damage. Now, really, to be quite honest, they have all AD. That's the only real disadvantage. If Team Purple decides to start stacking armor, which right now none of them are doing except, I guess, Aurelia. But if Purple decides to start stacking armor, they've got a clear advantage in the teamfights there. You see how much damage Amumu's taking from Vi, along with Nasus. And there's the tidal wave that's shut down there by Malzahar. See you later. Nice tidal wave to make sure that Nasus couldn't escape. Vi was able to Vault Breaker out of there. But again, coming from Malzahar, that shutdown that he has with the ultimate, with the root and the silence. Oh, what a great Aqua Prison landing there on Nasus. And he was actually not Nasus, excuse me, on Vi. Who was that? I think it was Vi that got landed on that. Now that's bothering me. Yeah, it was Vi, okay. I was like, wait a second, Nasus is dead. That didn't make sense, mouth. Yeah, landed on Vi. So 12 to 11, the first time in the game, or I guess second time in the game, that Team Purple has been leading in kills. They're currently still trailing in gold, though. Again, it all goes back to those dragon kills. They've let two get away from them now. Whoa, long range 10-mile bandage toss landing on Jinx, and almost a max range binding of binding. Dark binding. I almost call it Binding of Isaac. By the way, I just got done playing Binding of Isaac on stream, so that's where that came from. You see Gatecrash now pushing the inner turret at top lane with Nasus, and yeah, Siphoning Strike, it will do that. I'm curious to see how many stacks Nasus is actually at now. He's at, does that say 18 or 118? I can't tell. So Vi able to get the outer turret there in the mid lane. Whoa, Nami! Nami done goofed. Nami zigged when she should have zagged there, and a double kill for Jinx as well. They are going to be able to get the kill, the counter kill on Nasus, so it ends up being a 3-for-1's trade in favor of Purple, in favor of Blue, but Blue is also going to get a tier 2 turret here, and they may go for the inhibitor as well. Oh, it looks like they're going to go back. So Team Blue able to turn two turrets out of that. And once again, things have swung back in favor of Blue. Still up by 5,000 gold and now three turrets. Here comes Amumu. Amumu looking for his blue buff. He actually missed the... oh, is he going to land it? The banish shot lands on Ezreal, but now Amumu's fighting a 2v1. Despair is ticking rapidly. And there's the Curse of Sad Mommy! Amumu's going to get a double kill out of it. What a play by Leovon Newton. What a play. The dragon will be up in 1 second. And if Purple can get the dragon, they will catch back up in the gold very rapidly. I don't know why they're not going for dragon right now, but... a nice double kill there, 2v1, who cares, Amumu rocking and rolling with Rillias, and that did so much damage to Vi. Vi was not expecting that, and Curse of Sad Mommy completely dominating it. I don't know why Purple's not going for Dragon, though. They're prioritizing the red buff over Dragon. They can get an easy-peasy kill. You see Amumu now telling his team, hey, let's get Dragon. It just spawned, and it's actually been up for about a minute. So Amumu is going to try to turn this to a dragon kill. Purple really needs this. And Blue is aware of it. Here we go. They're going to try to contest the dragon. They are not going to get it. Miss Fortune able to get the kill. Nice job there. Kills go back in favor of Purple. Now trailing only by 3,000 gold. And considering how much they've been behind this game, that's quite a feat. At one point, the game was nearly even. Nice zap there landed. Oh, St. Ulfer's going for more. Nami in trouble. Assault and Battery is going to take her right into the cone of death there by Miss Fortune. I don't know. I'm not sure if Gatecrash should need to be using his ult, his flash. But now the power play lies once again with Team Blue. They need to not group up, though. If Malzahar gets a hold of their entire team and that ultimate, they are all dead. And here we go. He's going to go for it. He only shuts down Vi, but Vi is barely able to escape. Vi, pretty much the worst target he could have gone there. Any target would have been better because Vi can actually get out of the ultimate from Malzahar thanks to Vault Breaker. And Super Mega Death Rocket landing on the face of a Mumu didn't really take a whole lot of damage, though. So Nami is now back up, but she does not have Tidal Wave. And here we are once again. All tied up in kills, but the goal differential is just getting worse and worse for Team Blue. The dragon kill helped out a lot. Imagine if Purple did not get that dragon. Just think of how much further they'd be behind right now. And taking a look at their items, no one really building. I mean, to be honest, they need to be building more tanky. I'm surprised that Aurelia went for Berserker Greaves. I would have much preferred to see her go Ninja Tabby. And again, that is because they're basically facing an all AD comp. Minus Morgana, who's playing as support. I mean, I would even argue that Ninja Tabby is going to be better than Merc Treads because, you get the cooldown reduction thanks to Tenacity from the roots of Morgana, but that's really it. You do have a little bit of a stun reduction coming in from Jinx as well, but to be quite honest, I still would like to see Team Purple stacking armor. If they stack armor, that's really all they have to do. Blue's got to be careful. Nasus is going to get caught there by an Aqua Prism. And here comes a huge curse of the Sad Mummy. And he is knocked out of it by Vi. Down goes Jinx. Down goes Vi. Nasus is down as well. Mumu's been shut down. Tidal Wave rolls right over Morgana. It's going to be a 4-for-2 trade in favor of Purple. Purple on the warpath now, only trailing by 2,200 gold. That's exactly what they needed to happen. Malzahar's ult took the entire team out of that fight. And just like that, the team fighting of Purple really showing you how it's done. But Blue is not out of this game yet, but right now is Purple's time to shine. It's not late game yet. They still have plenty of time to end this game before Blue gets really scary. They need to turn this into possibly even a Baron kill. I would be okay with them backing off here, taking this turret and going straight for Baron. It's only Ezreal, although the rest of the team is now back up. Ezreal's going to get caught out, and there's going to be the soft ace. Malzahar getting the kill on Ezreal, and they're all backing up. What a play. What a team fight for Team Purple. Now trailing by only 800 gold. And up by 3 kills as well, but they're still down in turrets. Still down in gold, surprisingly. But that's exactly what they needed. So a fantastic team fight there by Purple. Malzahar taking the red buff because hell, why not? Jinx got to be careful. Both teams really need to be cautious about overextending. Oh no, Nami, you zigged when you should have zagged. Does Nami have flash? She does have flash. She could have gone over the tree line, but instead tried to set up a team fight, but now it's a 4v3. Nami goes down. Amumu's going to go down. I don't know if Aurelia is going to make it out as well. Assault and battery landing on Aurelia. Down she goes as well. And this might be a counter ace here if Purple's not careful. Gatecrasher is going to get shut down there by Malzahar. Beacons needs to be real careful. There you see Static Shiv landing. See you later. Down goes Jinx. And just like that, Team Blue is all of a sudden once again back up by 3,000 gold. It's been a game of one step forward, three steps back for Team Purple. And it was unfortunate that Nami got caught out there. That's exactly what I was talking about as I was saying it. Saw the overextension and Nami, not sure what she was doing. She could have flashed over the tree line. Instead of Mumu and Aurelia tried to help her out. She ended up dying anyway, and then the other three also bit the dust for it. So Team Blue really rocking and rolling. They're going to start taking out jungle buffs. Very, very little vision for Team Purple. Actually, Team Blue doesn't really have all that great vision either, but it doesn't matter. They've got complete map control. All lanes pushing towards Purple's main base here. And once again, Purple's going to find themselves needing a really good team fight. They got a huge gift wrap present, not in the shape of a Mumu, but it was in the shape of that last team fight. Oh, what a banish toss there, landing on Ezreal. Will Ezreal be able to escape? I don't think so. As long as a Mumu can land one more bandage toss, Despair is ticking, but it's not hitting anything. There's the flash right to the Curse of Sad Mummy, and Ezreal's not going to be able to escape. What a play there. A Mumu goes to 6-3-9 now. Fantastic plays by Amumu all around. But Purple still trailing by 3,300 gold. Oh, I don't know about this. It looks like Blue is going to be setting up an ambush right outside of Baron. I don't know if Purple is going to try to feint this. No, they know exactly where they are. Most of the damage has been exhausted on Amumu. Amumu's going to go down anyway, but there you see the Tidal Wave. Misfortune doing as much damage as possible. Assault and Battery landing on MF. Down she goes. Amumu's dead. Aurelia's dead. Double kill. Down goes Nami. Gatecrasher is just barely alive. That's going to be the ace. Double kill for Vi. Nasus did go down. Malzahar was able to get a double kill. Down with Nasus along with Morgana, but it's going to be an ace. And pretty much now, it just doesn't matter. It almost doesn't matter how good the old team fights did. The advantage that Purple had is now completely erased. So 26-24 as Blue pushing down the main base. Every single person of Team Purple is still down, and it does look like Blue may try to end it right here. So down goes the inhibitor, down goes the next inhibitor turret. Aurelia now coming in from the spawn. Nami there as well. They're both going to get wrapped up by choppers. And they do have minions on the Nexus turrets now, and Purple really all, or Blue, all they really need to do is back off. So Blue going in for the dragon kill, 26-24. As Purple now trails by 5,000, make it 6,200 gold. And Purple's defense is really going to be put to the test here. Again, they do have the better teamfight comp just because of the fact of the nature of all the ultimates. I mean, Nami, like I said, Nami and Amumu have great initiators. But Nami really needs to stop overextending. She's going to get caught out again. And if she does, at this point, Blue is big enough to where they can just absolutely destroy her. So Purple forced to go back and defend. And we're going to have to wait and see if Purple can get a miraculous defense. You see Zapner missing the mark. Again, it's all going to come down to how well Malzahar lands his ultimate. And if he could shut down, they really need to focus fire Jinx, get her out of there. Nasus is also quite the threat, but all eyes are going to be on this next team fight. So here we go. Oh, what a nice aqua prison there, landed by Nami. Misfortune goes for it. Nasus is free, going after Misfortune. Flash comes out there for Beacons. Down goes Nasus. What a play, but Soul Shackle is ticking on three members along with the Zonya's Hourglass. I don't know what Amumu was doing, but Amumu got caught out. Tried to get Curse of the Sad Mummy. Double kill there for Misfortune. They're still fighting it, but now it's going to start collapsing, and Team Purple is going to drop the Quadra kill to Jinx, and that will most likely be that. I don't see any way that they defend this now. Super Minions on the Nexus turrets, and that will be that. So game one goes to Team Blue. Purple really had a pretty good opportunity there in the midst of this game to take control of it, but again, one or two overextensions, and you see the problem with that. So game one goes to Blue. Great game all around by both teams. When we come back, we'll begin game number two here after the spectator delay. Remember, the spectator delay will be about 5 minutes or so. Don't go anywhere. This is Try Hard Thursday number 38. We'll be back in just a moment.
We'll be right back.
begin game number two here on Try Hard Thursday, number 38. Thank you, everyone who's been tuning in. And, of course, if you are watching this on YouTube, keep in mind that you can check anywhere at any time in the info box that there is an annotation that will allow you to skip all the loading and commercials and that sort of thing. Go straight to the game. Isn't that cool? Isn't that cool, man? Here we are, spawning on Summoner's Rift. Because my colorblind mode has reactivated, I hate it. Absolutely hate it. I wish it would stop doing that. Spawning for Team Blue. Let's choose the players right now. For Team Blue, ADC Tristana is going to be played by Shadow Fenwox. Not Phoenix, but Fenwox. His support's going to be played. Nami is going to be played by Ultraviolet Flight. Or Ultraviolet Fight, I should say. And oh, Nami's got to be careful. Let's go ahead and pause before things get out of control. Jungle Rengar is going to, well, I guess Team Blue's Jungle Rengar is going to be played by Surfer James. In the mid lane, playing as mid lane Yasuo is going to be Blahri 1-2. And last but not least, in the top lane is going to be DeKalsin playing as top lane Riven. And their opponents on the top lane playing as Draven. Yeah, might as well have been Draven. Playing as Darius is going to be Nasty Clown and playing top lane Darius. In the mid lane is going to be Twisted Fate played by Mord602. Tominator95 going to be playing the opposite of the other Jungle Rengar. And cheers to everyone because they picked the same skin, so this should be a lot of fun. Bot lane is going to be played by Queen of Murloc playing as support Soraka. And Skull CMK playing as ADC Kog'Maw. So here we go. Let's see how this one goes. I wanted to stop it there because I don't know how crazy it's about to get. But we'll have to wait and find out which Rengar will be superior. It's going to be Surfer James or Skull CMK. Now, I will say that the team, we tried to balance the teams as much as possible. I believe that one team is going to be comprised of three silvers, and the other team is going to be comprised of a Bronze League, a Silver League, and a Gold League. I don't remember which one's which. But again, we tried to balance it out as much as possible. It's impossible for us to know who's going to win, obviously, or if it's going to be balanced. We try to do the best that we can as far as the balance is concerned. But it is possible that you may see every now and then a player is overmatched in their lane. That's all right. We're not playing for anything other than funsies. So Team Blue looking like they want to do an ambush on the red buff. Darius is up here, and Nasty Clown will be able to know this is coming. Whether or not he's going to be able to prepare it, he's not looking at Darius right now. And Darius in a lot of trouble. It's going to be a 3-on-1 gank attempt here. Nasty Clown may be forced to flash. He doesn't have flash. Oh, he gets first blood, goes to Yasuo. About the worst target that could have gotten first blood. So Nasty Clown will go down immediately, and there goes the red buff as well for Rengar. Unfortunately, there's no warding, and Darius does not have flash. Which, again, it's not that uncommon for the top laners to not have flash, but it's just a bad thing all around. Again, you want to kind of position yourself in the river or inside of the bush. And the brush that I'm talking about is you either want to take a stake out here in this bush or standing at the tri bush, or even possibly what's more common for top laners to do is they'll stand right here. And that prevents that from happening, for the most part anyway. So a little bit of a misstep there for Team Purple, as Team Blue already up 1-0. And Darius is going to have a tough time up there in top lane against Riven. Mid lane, it could go either way. And, oh, here comes Tominator. He flashes away from Surfer James now. Surfer James trying to turn this one around. That'd be huge. Bolotos is going to land a Surfer James. He gets the kill anyway thanks to the red buff. I don't even think he needed to flash. So down goes Tominator as he gets another kill there for Team Blue. And Ignite goes out on DeKalsin. And he even uses flash. Will Nasty Clown be able to catch up to him in time? Not going to happen. So already Team Purple is trailing by a huge margin. We have Reindeer Kog'Maw. Nice stun there on Blahri. Blahri's got to be careful. Yasuo pretty much shreds any mid lane caster for most of the game, but he's not invincible. There's a nice grab there by Nasty Clown. Riven with the stun. And can Riven get away? I don't think so. It's taking tons of creep damage. And will Nasty Clown get the kill? Oh, it's so close. So close. Not able to do it. Nasty Clown forced to back away, taking two shots from the turret. Falling dangerously low. Mord looking for the gold card stun. Not going to happen. Both top laners opting for the longsword instead of going for Doran's. Or even going for Doran's shield. I'm actually surprised that we're not seeing Riven go for Doran's shield to start off with. would definitely help out against Darius. Darius able to go, able to immediately grab the Vampiric Scepter. Right now, Team Blue already up by 800 gold. You see the newly reworked Soraka. The new Soraka is pretty awesome. I'm probably gonna end up having to buy her if I don't own her already. I get gifted so many champions. I know this is like first world streamer problem, but I don't know what champions I own anymore because my fans, they gift me champions, they give me skins, and I'm completely grateful for it. Don't take that as being disingenuous. It's amazing, but it creates a problem where I don't remember which champions I actually own anymore. I guess it's a good problem to have. Lucard now was not able to be stopped there by Windwall. And once again, we see Nami taking on Soraka in the bot lane. Now, normally I'd say that usually favors Nami quite a bit, but since the rework, Soraka can be quite the nuisance to deal with there. As Blar is going to get ignited, tries to use Tempest away. Oh, I think that ignite's not going to be enough. No! Blari able to escape with literally no health. How much health does Yasuo have? 19 health after that. So close. One more auto attack. Would have done it. If Wildcard would have hit, man, that would have been great. Someone asking, why does Yasuo have a shield? I'm not sure why Yasuo has Doran's shield, to be quite honest. So 2-0 in favor of Team Blue right now. Riven's got to be careful, man. She's not really respecting the damage of Darius. At the same time, Darius does not have... I mean, he also did not build tanky, and Riven can easily burst that down. I'm not quite sure what Riven's going to be building into. I was surprised to see Nasty Clown rush for a Vampiric Scepter on Darius. Of course, I don't play Darius. I don't play top lane, so there might be something that I don't know. I actually did get gifted Riven by... somebody. I think it may have been Surfer James. It was either him or Wozbeck, I think. Anyway, I did play Riven. She's actually quite fun. She's a lot more fun to play than I remember her in that Air Amazing. Let's put it that way. So 2-0 in favor of Blue is quickly quieted down here. You see the new star call, more like meteor call from Soraka. No kills yet for Team Purple. Very, very near miss on the kill we saw a couple moments ago on Yasuo. Ignite not able to take him down. I was surprised that that wasn't enough to kill him. So there's the nice Aqua Prison there landing on Soraka. Didn't really hit the mark on Kog'Maw. Oh, what? So much damage. Here comes the Diggity Dunk from Darius. Is he going to land it? No! No, it was not there. I was surprised that Darius didn't go for the XQ. He easily could have. He could have easily cleaved Riven in half, but did not happen. Another missed opportunity for Purple as Riven's going to be able to go back. I suppose that they could be both of them could be going for possibly the Hydra, or at least maybe going to Tiamat and then stopping. But again, I don't play top lane. We go, you see Rengar now. One of the Rengar is going to be the blue Rengar. It's a call of Surfer James. Going to go for a gank attempt on Twisted Fate. Twisted Fate's got to be careful. He doesn't even see Rengar coming in from the side. Forced to flash away. Is going to get snared there by Rengar. Nice kill by Surfer James. Cisco's to Yasuo and Team Blue rocking and rolling. Rocket Jump now landing on Kog'Maw. Saved by Queen of Murloc. Very nice heal there. But 3-0 right now is Purple already starting out to a very rough start. Blue up by 1,000 gold. Nice Aqua Prison there landing on Kog'Maw. And again, I feel Riven doesn't really respect the damage of Darius. The Coulson's got to be careful here. Nasty Clown, however, is taking so much damage. But there you see the Darius dunk landing right on Riven. Should have happened the last time. Here comes the Destiny in right on top of Yasuo. Yasuo landing last breath. Doesn't even matter. Didn't he barely do any damage to Twisted Fate. As Yasuo has an interesting build so far. Again, I raise a question to the Doran Shield. I mean, I guess it blocks Twisted Fate's basics, but... other than that, it's not going to be helping him out all that much. Tristana already has a BF sword. Kog'Maw looking like he's going for the Triforce early. So it's going to be Nasty Colin getting the first kill. What a flash there by Tominator. Unfortunately, he's not going to be in time to catch Surfer James. And now Tominator's got to be careful because Riven is now back in lane. I don't know if he could. There really was no use of him using the flash there. If Tominator had simply just used the bushes here on the blue buff, he could have easily slunk in from behind, stayed right here, and waited for Surfer James to get low there. As we do miss a kill, apologies about that. I'll go take a look at it right now. In the mid lane, it looked like Blari was trying to go back, and he is going to get clipped there by Twisted Fate's Q. And TF sees that he was trying to go back. Is he going to go for the kill? And yeah, that was a long distance shot. Mord getting gift wrapped, an easy peasy kill. So go back to the live feed now. Darius doing a pretty good job keeping Riven at bay. I really feel that that's a matchup Riven should win on paper. Ultraviolet Fight missing a rare miss there on the Aqua Prison. So right now, Team Purple is doing a pretty good job at keeping even, especially after the rough going that they had early on. Only trailing by about 200 gold, which would represent the difference of first blood along with the difference in farm. But if you take a look at it, all lanes outside of the jungle are pretty much outside of the jungle and support lane are on Purple's side. So Yasuo is going to go for Zeal, and not quite sure what Yasuo is going to be building for that. I'm genuinely curious. I guess he's going for a Blade of Avarice and into Yumu's, but gotta be careful. Here comes the tidal wave all the way from way downtown, landing right on Soraka. Surfer James leaping on top of Skull CMK. Kog'Maw not going to be able to escape. Unfortunately, Cathian Surprise is not going to get anything. The Kalsa is going to get ignited. Another kill goes to Nasty Clown, going to 2-1-0. Riven falling to 0-2-1. Surfer James goes to 3-0 on Rengar, though, and that's going to be a huge problem later on as this game goes into the mid-game stages here for Team Purple. A fed Rengar is going to be quite the terror indeed. So, Soraka is the only defense that this outer turret has, and I think she will be able to hold. Shadow Phoenix has to be a little bit careful there, as Soraka's no slouch. There's Last Breath landing on Twisted Fate, but you see there does literally no damage. Here comes the counter stun from Mord. Blari trying. He really wants a kill. Oh, but he takes a shot and a stun underneath the turret. Down goes Yasuo. 4-4 now as Purple rocketing into the gold lead by 100. The first time they've led in gold all game. Very nice job indeed by Purple. Pulling it back and evening the game. Look at that. It's completely even on the score and kills. It's literally completely even. So Tristana going back and... she looks like Tristana's going to be building Bloodthirster. I was kind of expecting the Infinity Edge there. Looks like she is going to go for Bloodthirster. Right now to 12 and a half minutes, taking a look at the overall gold earned. No surprise, Surfer James and Rengar sitting at almost 4,000 champion value for Team Blue. Team Purple looking in the mid lane at Twisted Fate. Nicely done indeed, almost 4,000 champion value on Mord 602. You see a Meteor Call landing there for Soraka. I think that Star Call needs to be renamed to Meteor Call, I feel. Blue buff transfer there to Tominator to Twisted Fate. And Rengar, Surfer James is finding himself out in the pretty much in the middle of nowhere. He's on an island with no escape. He's going to leap on top of Darius, and Darius called for help. I don't know where Team Purple was, but they knew that Rengar was over there. And unfortunately, Darius got hung out to dry. He did finish that Blade of the Rune King. But I feel that Twisted Fate and Rengar had gone there. You saw the ping coming in from Darius. He knew that Rengar was there, but unfortunately he got no backup. It was an easy peasy kill for Riven. And Riven goes, that's our first kill of the game. So power play in favor of Team Blue right now. Darius is back up. And he is currently using his teleport, so not much is lost there except a missed opportunity to take out Rengar. They really need to slow down Surfer James. Tominator, oh, with a missed Bola. You can't, oh, you got to be careful, Tominator. You saw it was a full Savagery Bola toss as well, which would have rooted Yasuo for 3 seconds. But I think it's either 3 or 2 seconds or 1.5. I don't know. I don't play this game. 5-4 as Team Blue leading it by the tune of 100 gold. Very, very even matchup. Once again, you see Yasuo there having difficulties with the range of TF. The Carlson is going to get grabbed here by Darius with a diggity dunk. Didn't hit on the mark. He's going to get ignited, but there's going to be the kill anyway thanks to the passives. See you later. Another kill goes to Nasty Clown. 3-2-0 now. Top lane Darius completely dominating the lane. Very nicely job. Very nicely done indeed. So they're not. Neither one of the teams are building. Doesn't look like the top laners anyway. Darius was going for Blade of the Rune King. I guess Riven could still technically be going for a Tiamat, but I feel like she probably would have built it by now. And the outer turret is going to go down here very soon, although Kog'Maw doing a surprising amount of damage on Ultraviolet Fight on Nami. Got to be careful about that. Warding looks very good for Team Purple. They've got wards everywhere where they needed to be, pretty much, outside of the top lane. But very nice warding job by Purple all around. As someone who mains a support, I love seeing good vision. There's nothing more fun for me than seeing a good support player. It's kind of like, and this is something I think I made this analogy a couple of weeks ago on Trier Thursday. It's kind of like, well, hold that thought here, as Kog'Maw is, they're setting it up for Destiny. Mord comes in, actually misses the mark on his Q, and Ultraviolet Fight trying to escape. She's got Ignite ticking. No mana, though, for the, or she did have mana, but she didn't have the cooldown for the heal, as the kill on Nami is going to go to Twisted Fate. It's going to be his third of the day. But an analogy that I made a couple of weeks ago was, it's for me, watching a good support, it's like being an offensive lineman. And again, hold that thought here, is Rengar going to go after Soraka, forces the flash away, but Rengar not able to finish her off. Although Soraka needs to be cautious, she's not safe here. Surfer James is completely full health, and he already has four stacks of savagery, or ferocity. But if you're a football player and you've ever played on the defensive line or offensive line, you're really the only people who are going to spot really good blocking plays in the NFL. Or concurrently, if you see like a good outfielder or something like that. It's a little things that you pick up on. Like a Zerg player is never going to be that impressed with maybe some crazy micro from a Terran player, but like really good worker control, for example, is fascinating to watch. Same thing goes along the lines. It's the same train of thought here with me watching support players. I can really appreciate really good support players, and that's why I love watching bot lane. I love watching the great supports all over the world here, as we are going to see a 2v1 here on Mord. He's forced to Zonya's, and he is not going to be able to escape out of that. He's going to try, but he's going to die trying. So, and more bad news for Team Purple, as now Rengar gets the shutdown gold. Surfer James sitting at 4-0 as Blue is moving up. They did take out the outer turret in the support lane, and they are going to get another easy-peasy turret here in the mid lane. So 6-6 overall. Purple only down by 300 gold, but Rengar is really going to become a problem. He already has his Feral Flare. He's got Tiamat, as you see there as well. So a Hydra on Rengar is quite standard and also quite scary. Have to wait and find out. Riven, once again, is pretty much solo pushing this top lane. I don't know where Darius is, but if Riven gets that outer turret in the top lane, that's going to be bad news for Purple, as they're going to be trailing by 3 turrets. Riven is forced off of the turret there by Twisted Fate. Ultraviolet Fight lands a huge Aqua Prison. Here comes Tristana, and the Tidal Wave is going to miss Soraka. I don't think Soraka has anywhere to run, but now they have to worry about Kog'Maw. Kog'Maw missing Living Artillery is going to get completely shut down by Nami. And where's Tristana? She's got to come back and help out Ultraviolet Fight. Although Skull CMK not doing enough damage at the same time, Server James is going to get leapt on by 3 people, and he's, there's no way, don't tell me he's going to escape. Nasty Cloud could get the diggity dunk. There it is, see you later, shut down. Down goes Rengar, and Darius dunking his way to 4-2-0. Nicely done there, getting the shutdown gold on Rengar. That's going to be Server James' first death of the day, and Riven has no way of stopping this turret from going down. So solid plays there by Purple. Really, I mean, they're taking a step back, but they're also taking the same step forward. So it's not like the last Team Purple. And Nami's got to be careful. Living Artillery, even though with that increased mana cost per use, still does a ton of damage. Kog'Maw doesn't have Triforce quite yet, as he's been completely bullied out of the farming by Tristana, who is your overall CS leader. As it stands right now, Purple up 1,000 gold. Taking a look at the overall champion values once again, it is going to be no surprise. Surfer James sitting at 6,400 gold. Second place is going to be Tristana, 5,700 for Team Blue. On Team Purple, it's going to be mid lane Mord, surprisingly, over Darius, 6,400. On Twisted Fate, Darius sitting at about 6,100. So far, a very, very close matchup, which is good, which makes me feel good. That means that I balanced the teams about as good as they possibly could have gotten. So 400 gold lead for Team Purple. They are trailing by one turret, however. And there's a nice, another nice Aqua Prison landed there by Ultraviolet Fight. But here comes Rengar now, stalking in the bushes. And you did see they have a ward. They saw the ping going out as well. At the same time, Nasty Clown is going to be fighting a 2v1. Goes for the dunk on Riven. He's able to get him, but now he's going to have to deal with Yasuo. Shutdown gold goes to Blari. And man, oh man, did Yasuo really, really need that gold. And he was actually building a static shiv, which makes complete sense now. So it's going to be another turret down, as all outer turrets for Purple have been killed. 8-8, 300 gold lead in favor of Team Blue. But if you look at the scores, I mean, it's been pretty much even, but the turrets tell a different story. I guess I didn't really think about Yasuo possibly building a static shiv first, which is, to be honest, is one of the best items that you can build early on a mid laner. And Tristana has nowhere to run. Here comes Rengar, but unfortunately, oh, he is able to get the kill. And Servant James has too much damage. Trying to get a double kill there. You see how much damage the sustain he has. Almost gets Mord, and the red buff is going to get it, a double kill. Servant James turning a what should have been a 2-for-1, if that, into a 2-for-2. And that's the power of Rengar. That sustain coming in from the Hydra and the Feral Flare, man. I'm telling you, that is scary, scary times. So Ultraviolet Fight sees the Observer Ward, is going to take that down. But still, a 200 gold lead separates these two teams. Purple back in the lead. Ultraviolet Fight dodges the Living Artillery, tries to land an Aqua Prison, didn't work. And I'm surprised that Kog'Maw, well, I guess it wouldn't make sense for Kog'Maw to pursue that now that I think about it. They did see Riven and Yasuo kind of stalking in the mid lane, trying to decide where Purple was going to go. Dragging up in 3 seconds, you see Purple pinging for it. And Nasty Clown's going to engage here. I don't know why he's jumping into a 3v1. He's got no backup. Kills Riven anyway, so what do I know? Now it's a 3v3 as Tominator comes in from the side on Rengar. But Surfer James is now back up on his Rengar, sitting at 6-2-2. And he even went for Giant's Belt. Looks like he's possibly going to be building right into Randuin's, which would certainly help him in this team fight. So no power plays, as the top laners both did get killed off. And there's a Flash 4 coming in with a gold card stun on Tristana. Not enough, though. Again, it's hard to really gank Tristana like that, just due to the nature of Rocket Jump. Skull CMK trying to get away from Rengar, is not going to escape. Here comes the Cathian Surprise, is going to land on Blari. And look at that, a double kill for Rengar. Tominator trying to square off against Surfer James. Surfer James trying to end it, but he can't do it. There you see. Oh, the Roar was able to heal him long enough. Surfer James is going to go down, but again, huge plays there by Rengar. Unfortunately for Team Blue, they did drop 4-for-2. As Skull CMK's Akathian Surprise really helped them out. And that's pretty much what pushed Tristana and Yasuo over the edge as far as death is concerned. And they really should be going either for the turret. They should finish off this turret, go straight for the dragon. As Purple fighting a stay in this game, and Riven going after Mord. Darius is going after the turret, which they should have done. Nice play there with Zonya's Hourglass, able to stop the damage coming in from Riven's ultimate. And will Nasty Clown get the dunk? No, he's going to miss it. It's going to be an air ball, unfortunately. He tried to get her with the ignite, didn't happen. Solid plays all around from both teams, though. Very, very close match. 1,700 gold separates these two. It's purple now looking like they want to make a play for the dragon. A surprisingly quiet game for Tristana so far. She's got plenty of good items, but she hasn't really. I mean, she's pretty much been doing farming, which I'm not gonna hate on her for it. It's surprising to see that she hasn't really had a huge impact in these big team fights. You do see there, the second dragon goes to purple. And purple now extending their gold lead by about 3,000 gold nearly. And really, I feel that these two the team fights for both teams are pretty close to being even. I'd have to give the slight edge to a Team Blue just because of Nami. But that's a very, very, very slight edge. And again, you can't really discount the power of Soraka's heal as well. As well as her, really the biggest threat for Soraka now, she actually kind of acts like, if you want to think of it this way, she acts almost like Malzahar in a way that she gets that silence and the slow. If, for those of you who don't know, the reworked Soraka loadout, I believe it's her W, I want to say, is the one that drops the silencing zone circle on the ground. And basically what happens is if you stand it, while you're inside of that zone, you're silenced. And if you stay there for a second and a half, you are stunned. Or I guess I should say rooted for a small amount of time. And it is very, very, very good in team fights, mainly due to the silence, though, not the slow. So blue buff transfer there to Mord on Twisted Fate, who's surprisingly not going for a Lich Bane. Honestly, I would have expected Lich Bane to be coming out before Deathfire Grass. I mean, I understand Zhonya's Hourglass, especially when he's going up against Yasuo in mid. Definitely getting Zhonya's would have been the first choice that I would have played. Or I would have picked anyway. I have played Twisted Fate before. But I probably would have followed that up with Lich Bane. I would have done Lich Bane and then possibly get the Boots of Mobility. But again, I'm not playing. I'm just casting as Mord is going to find himself in the middle a 4v1 massacre. So he was actually almost able to kill Ultraviolet Fight there if he wasn't careful. Twisted Fate does so much damage. So power play is going to be on the favor of Team Blue. There's that silencing zone that I was talking about. I'm trying to remember the name of the W of... I know it's Starcall. I almost want to say Equinox. Is that right? I'm curious. Yeah, Equinox. Yeah, there we go. I've actually played Soraka enough to remember most of her move names, and they're amazing. Never played her in a real game, however. Or I guess I should say in the Summoner's Rift game. Here we go. Server James going right after Tomnair. Ends up turning around on Darius, and Darius pulled Rengar in. I'm not sure if that was the best move, but down goes Rengar. Down goes Darius as well. However, Server James has been taken out of this fight. Mord 602 back up on Twisted Fate, and what a nice wind wall there by Blari on Yasuo, stopping so much damage that was aimed right at DeKalsin. Fantastic play there by Blari with that wind wall. And finally, here comes Tristana now getting involved. Rocket jump, see you later. So much damage from Trist. You see Equinox going down on the ground as no one wants to be standing inside of that. So Kog'Maw and Soraka are able to hold this turret for pretty much indefinitely until their team can come back and help them out. Twisted Fate falling to 5-5-5. Kog'Maw did finish off that Triforce. By the way, Tristana did get the Infinity Edge first before the Bloodthirster, which is what I was expecting to see, but I guess that she wanted to spend a little bit of gold there on the early Vampiric Scepter, which makes sense for an ADC. I mean, it keeps them in. It increases their in-lane sustainability tenfold. And then finishing off the IE, getting Zerka's Grieve, and then turning the Vampiric Scepter into a Bloodthirster. It also could be turned into a Blade of the Rune King, which that actually looks like what Tristana may be building there. Seventeen to six is Team Purple now, still leading in gold. They're up by about 1,100 gold. They're down by one turret. Also down by one kill, not that big of a deal. And is that a Hurricane that I see on Twisted Fate? Is he going for it? It looks like he actually could be going for a Hurricane, a Runin's Hurricane, which is that would be quite hilarious to see on Twisted Fate. But hold that thought here as Carlson forces the flash away on Twisted Fate. You see Equinox again landing there on the ground. But I don't think I've ever seen a Hurricane on Twisted Fate. So that's going to be quite fascinating to watch in a team fight. Server James sitting at 5 stacks of Ferocity, looking to use Savagery. He actually uses it way early. I don't know what Server James is doing. He's going to end up wasting Savagery here. He's just going to go for it. Leaps on Mort. Instantly gets stunned. Dunked by Darius. See you later. Here comes the tidal wave coming in from Nami. Rengar coming in from the backside. Goes right after Yasuo. Yasuo ends up dying anyway to Kog'Maw. And Dominator was going after Nami in the back line there. Unfortunately, he was not able to grab her. So what a nice turnaround there for Team Blue, to able to get a really solid engagement after kind of a dodgy engagement by Surfer James and Rengar. Ended up sealing the deal. Here's going to be the ace. Queen of Murloc not going to be able to escape, as we do see Shadow Phoenix now finally getting involved. Not that he wasn't involved anyway, but really slamming it shut on Team Purple with Tristana. Now that's when she starts to become a real big problem, is when she gets rocking and rolling with that attack speed, as you do see there, with that IE, and things are only going to get more difficult for Purple. They really need to force a good team fight. But like I said, I'm going to give the slight team fighting edge to Blue for that very reason, because of the fact that Tidal Wave can be casted from about 10 miles away. It is such a good initiator. And really, I feel that Rengar should have probably waited for the Tidal Wave before using Savagery and then hopping on in there. I feel like it would have gone much, much... That probably would have ended up a bigger slaughter than it actually was for Team Blue. If Rengar saved Savagery, waited for the Tidal Wave, and then left on Twisted Fate while they were all slowed by because of the Tidal Wave, I think it would have gone a lot better, as he was already exposed by the time he tried to leap on top of Twisted Fate. At that time, all he needs to do is flash and stun. That's pretty much it. So here comes Server James again, going right after Morty. He's going to get gold stunned there, and Server James is going to try to pursue this. He's actually going to end up getting a kill, I believe. Where's the Zonias? Did not happen. Twisted Fate goes down. Here comes DeKalsen. DeKalsen's going to get completely destroyed by Rengar. And look at this! Team Purple swapping it on completely switching it up on Team Blue. I believe that's called a done goofed. Team Blue done goofed now, getting a 3-for-1 trade in favor of Purple. There's a solid re-engagement there by Purple. They backed off after losing Mord. Rengar came in from the side along with Nasty Clown from the Purple jungle and get re-engaged beautifully. Took Riven out instantly. Rengar was devoured and Yasuo could not escape. So a really nice turnaround there by Team Purple. That's exactly what they needed. Gold is completely even right now. The first Baron kill is going to go to Team Purple. Blue has no vision on Baron's lair. They only have one in pretty much in mid lane. That is it. And Dominator is going to be able to just barely live through that, but now everything, all eyes are on Team Purple. If they can get back to base, heal up, and then go for a gut shot right down the middle, that would be huge. It's 23-22, Blue leads in kills, but right now Purple has all momentum thanks to a solid re-engagement. Cannot stress how good that re-engagement was. You see Hurricane on a Twisted Fate. Very rare to see a Runan's Hurricane on Twisted Fate. Unless that's a new meta that I'm not aware of. Tristana did indeed finish off her GA. Nasty Clown opted to go for Warmogs. As well, Darius is going to be super duper hard to take down, especially with that Hydra and Blade of the Rune King. So here we go again. All momentum. This is really Purple's game. Honestly, this is Purple's game and Purple's fight to lose. They've got Baron. Team Blue, for whatever reason, is trying to push this. They know they do have a ward down. Blue does know that Purple did get Baron. So normally the play would be to sit back and play defensive, wait for the Baron buff to go off, or wait for Purple to overextend and make a huge error. And blue, if they get caught out by anyone on purple, the engagement's going to be not too good for blue. But here we go. Server James once again engaging without the rest of his team. You do see random ones going off, but Server James going to get destroyed. Down goes Ribbon. Double kill for Tominator. And Tristana trying to leap away. There's so much damage coming from Kog'Maw as well. And that's exactly what I was talking about. I'm not sure why blue was hell-bent on forcing an engagement. Board 602 destinying right into Tristana, though, as Guardian Angel is going to res her back up. Tominator is going to get killed by Tristana thanks to the turret. And a really, really, I don't want to call it sloppy engagement, but it was a bold move to get caught out there with knowing full well that purple had the Baron buff. You see the Ace there finish off by Nasty Clown. They are going to get this inhibitor turret, possibly the inhibitor as well. I don't know where Soraka was. I'm not sure if Soraka is disconnected. I did not see a message, but given the way that she's moving, it looks like Soraka may have disconnected. I couldn't tell with the entire with all the craziness going on, but again, I'm not sure why blue tried. They were just hell bent on forcing an engagement out in the middle of nowhere, full on knowing that purple had the Baron buff and they were at a disadvantage. You want to be fighting that team fight. Look, that team fight's going to happen either way. You want that team fight happening underneath your turrets rather than just out in the middle of nowhere. Nasty Clown does get caught trying to go back there. I'm not sure how they actually knew the Nasty Clown was there. So 26-27 as purple really did a solid effort, a number on Team Blue, but they were able to grab an inhibitor turret along with the inhibitor. So Mort is going to be forced. He doesn't want to mess with Tristana. I don't blame him, actually. Tristana looking like she wants to go for Blade of the Rune King. 264 CS and counting for Shadow Fenwox on Tristana, who is by far the overall CS leader. Kog'Maw in second place with 200. And look how much damage she's doing to Twisted Fate, although Kog'Maw absolutely lighting Tristana up. See you later. Lighting her up like a Christmas tree. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Kog'Maw taking down Tristana. A little bit of an overextension there by Shadow Fenwox, as it can't really, that's stuff you can't have happening. To be sure, the ADC cannot go down like that, especially when the game is this close. So Skull CMK really starting to get rocking and rolling now on Kog'Maw, even has a last whisper. Blue looking like they want to make a, or I'm sorry, purple looking like they may want to, I'm not sure what they're doing. The Baron's not going to be up for quite a while. And Mort is going to get caught off as well. That's also something that can't happen. Surfer James, if he takes down Mort, that's going to be huge. There you see it. Down goes Twisted Fate. And again, talking about overextending, you can't let that happen. But if anything, that brings purple, it actually brings purple at the disadvantage, because now that Tristana's back up, if this team fight happens, purple's going to be in for a world of hurt without Twisted Fate's control. To 27, 6,000 gold lead in favor of purple. Still up by one turret, but right now the momentum has swung back in blue's favor. You see Baron Asher responding about a minute 53 seconds. So it looks like we're going to hit a little bit of a lull here as we both teams kind of waiting to see what happens with Baron. And I don't believe that blue knows the timing on Baron, because they did not have a ward. The only ward they had at the time Baron went down was in the mid lane. It was nowhere near the lair. We just see Soraka. She apparently did, Soraka did indeed disconnect, which is what it looked like. So 7,500 gold lead in favor. Excuse me. That's going to be. I don't know where I got 7,500. Let's try that again. That's going to be 13,000. No, not, what's wrong? I can't even count anymore. I'm not even going to try to count anymore. Let's try a 6,000 gold lead. I was right the first time. DeKalsen gets blown up by Rengar and lickety split. See you later. Down goes Riven. Riven finally able to finish off Randuin's there. Tidal wave. That's a defensive tidal wave. to force the disengage. But 40 seconds left on Baron. This is pretty much what it's going to come down to. Purple really did not gain too much out of that last team fight because the inhibitors respawned. They didn't really gain any traction in mid lane. And again, Purple knows the timing on Baron. Blue does not know the timing on Baron. Both Rengars now showing you the reason why they're feared out of pretty much any other jungler. They can, I mean, a fed Rengar, I'm trying to think what would be a scarier jungler that would be fed. It's hard to think of one as far as the 1v1 pretty much just insta-giving prowess is concerned. I'd say Rengar Kha'Zix to a certain extent, but I'd still be more scared of Rengar. So 29 to 27. It's down to just under 7,000 gold lead in favor of Purple. They see Baron's back up. Now, there is a ward for Team Blue. Blue knows that Baron is back up now. And we will have to wait and find out exactly what's going to become of it. As we approach the over 40-minute mark here for game number 2 of Trier Thursday, number 38. And it does look like this Baron fight is going to happen. Now, whether or not Purple is trying to feign an attack here, I'm not quite sure. Blue knows about it, and Blue is ready for it as well. This is all going to come down to taking Rengar out of the fight. Whichever Rengar dies first, that's the team that is going to lose this team fight. I'm calling it right now, and again, I give a slight edge to Purple. I'm sorry, a slight edge to Blue, just based on Tsunami, and Soraka needs to be a little bit careful. Tidal Wave, I mean, not Tsunami. Well, I mean, you might as well call her Tsunami. Here we go, Baron already at 50% and falling. Blue needs to contest this. They can't let this go without a fight. There you do see Equinox landing, and Surfer James going to go for it. Nasty Clown taking tons of damage. Going to get dunked on. See you later, Surfer James. Down goes Rengar, and the team fight is going Purple's way easily as we're going to see bodies flying everywhere. Down goes Nami. Down goes Riven. Down goes Tristana. There's the triple kill, and what did I say? Whichever team's Rengar went down first is going to be the team that is going to be coming out at the disadvantage. And Purple absolutely mollywopped Team Blue. So Purple looking to drive this one home. They've got an exposed inhibitor in the mid lane and a 12,700 gold lead. So after a rough start, Team Purple looking like they're on the verge of taking one back, getting their first win in 3 weeks here, as many as 3 weeks on Tryhard Thursday. Yeah, just let anyone tank the turret shots. Who cares? Just go for the win. Soraka taking a lot of damage there. I don't know why they're waiting for the creep. They're giving Blue enough time to res here. They're going to try to take out the last Nexus turret. It is going to go down. So will the Nexus go down? I think it will. And Team Purple is going to bring one back for the good guys. Purple able to seal the deal. Job well done by both teams. And Purple finally able to grab a win 3 weeks later. So thank you, everyone who watched the show. I do appreciate it. Thank you to all the players as well. For those of you watching on YouTube, I also thank you very much indeed. Don't forget that SS Radio number 105 or 106, something like that, is going to be coming up on this Sunday at 6 p.m. Central, 7 p.m. Eastern, and 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. For those of you who are fans of the Twitch channel, you don't want to miss it. And, of course, for those of you watching live, I'm going to run a block of ads here and close out the show. Thank you for watching, everyone. I hope you enjoyed it. I'll see you all on Friday for Friday Night Fan Fights. And if not, then have a great weekend. Start to your weekend. Enjoy some football. Enjoy being out of work, being out of class, or whatever tickles your fancy. And I'll see you next time here for more Tryhard Thursdays. So long, everybody.